Tent or Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Scienceblind: Why Our Intuitive Theories About the World Are So Often Wrong, by Andrew Shtulman, narrated by Barry Abrams. 1. Why We Get the World Wrong. Most people today wouldn't classify milk as a health hazard. To us, it's an innocuous form of nutrition, poured over cereal or consumed with cookies. Milk was not always so innocuous, though. Only a century ago, it was a leading cause of foodborne illness in the industrialized world. Drinking cow's milk is not inherently dangerous, humans have been doing so for millennia, but it becomes dangerous if too much time has passed between when the milk is collected and when the milk is consumed. Milk is typically consumed without heating, and heat is what kills the bacteria inherent in our food. Milk is also high in sugar and fat, which makes it a perfect medium for bacterial growth. The negligible amount of bacteria present in milk when it is collected grows exponentially with each passing hour, a biological fact that milk consumers never really grappled with until the dawn of the Industrial Revolution in the latter half of the 19th century. The Industrial Revolution changed the landscape of where people worked and thus where they lived. As the population of Europe and the United States shifted from the country, where people worked on farms, to the city, where they worked in factories, people no longer lived close to the cows that produced their milk. Dairy farmers began transporting milk farther and farther from its source, which meant that people began drinking milk longer and longer after it had been collected. This combination of factors, that milk is consumed cold, that milk is an ideal incubator for bacteria, and that milk was being consumed days after its collection, led to several mass epidemics of milk-borne disease in Europe and the United States. The epidemics included outbreaks of tuberculosis, typhoid, scarlet fever, and cowpox. Milk in the 19th century was, according to one medical expert, as deadly as Socrates' hemlock. The problem of how to safely consume milk several hours or days after its collection was solved in the 1860s with a relatively simple process: heating milk for long enough to kill most of the bacteria within, but not so long as to alter its sensory qualities or nutritional value. This method of food treatment, devised by Louis Pasteur, came to be known as pasteurization. The health consequences of pasteurization were immediate and immense. Those most at risk of milk-borne disease in the 19th century were infants, as infants fed cow's milk were several times more likely to die than those fed from the breast. After pasteurization was introduced, however, infant mortality rates in urban centers dropped by around 20%. Today, pasteurized milk is considered one of the safest foods to consume, associated with less than 1% of all foodborne illnesses. Oddly, however, people are increasingly opting to drink unpasteurized milk, and as a consequence, the rates of milk-borne disease are rising. Between 2007 and 2009, the United States experienced 30 outbreaks related to the bacteria Campylobacter, Salmonella, and E. coli, outbreaks linked to the consumption of unpasteurized milk. Between 2010 and 2012, that number rose to 51. People are increasingly buying raw, unpasteurized milk for a variety of beliefs: that raw milk tastes better than pasteurized milk, that raw milk has higher nutritional content than pasteurized milk, which it does not, that raw milk is what humans were intended to drink, and that consumers should have the right to choose whether their milk is pasteurized or not. Those who reject pasteurized milk in favor of a more natural alternative do so seemingly blind to the fact that, before the advent of pasteurization, thousands of people suffered organ failure, miscarriage, blindness, paralysis, and even death at the hands of milk-borne diseases. Do people fully understand what they are rejecting when they reject pasteurizing? Probably not. pasteurization is counterintuitive. It's counterintuitive because germs are counterintuitive. Germs are living things that cannot be seen. They are passed from one host to another without detection, and they make us ill several hours or days after we come in contact with them. Also counterintuitive is the idea that germs transform our food from sources of nutrition to sources of disease, but that we can stop germs from doing so by killing them with heat. Heating foods to kill germs is a widespread practice in the food industry. Several types of food are pasteurized or otherwise heat-treated before they hit the shelves. Beer, wine, juice, canned fruits, canned vegetables, not just milk. When advocates for unpasteurized milk fail to similarly advocate for unpasteurized beer or unpasteurized canned peaches, two reasons seem likely. Either they believe that foregoing pasteurization is a justified risk for milk but not for other foods, or, more likely, they fail to understand what pasteurization is and why it is a necessary safeguard against foodborne illness. The science behind pasteurization is as sound as science gets, but many people reject this science. They reject not just the science behind pasteurization, but science in general, from immunology to geology to genetics. A recent survey of American adults found that only 65% believe that humans have evolved over time, compared with 98% of the members of the world's largest scientific society, the American Association for the Advancement of Sciences, AAAS. Only 50% of American adults believe that climate change is due mostly to human activity, compared with 87% of AAAS members. And only 37% of American adults believe that genetically modified foods are safe to eat, compared with 88% of AAAS members. Science denial is not a modern phenomenon. Most people denied that the Earth orbits the sun, that the continents are drifting, or that disease is caused by germs when those ideas were first proposed. Still, resistance to science in today's age, an age flush with scientific information and science education, requires explanation. Many scholars and media pundits point to ideology as an explanation, either political ideology or religious ideology. Others point to misinformation, as when vaccines were falsely linked to autism or when genetically modified foods were falsely linked to cancer. All these factors have been shown to play a role in science denial. Conservatives are less likely to accept science than liberals. Religious individuals are less likely to accept science than secular individuals. And misinformation breeds skepticism and hostility toward scientific ideas. But these factors are not the only causes of science denial. Psychologists have uncovered another: intuitive theories. Intuitive theories are our untutored explanations for how the world works. They are our best guess as to why we observe the events we do and how we can intervene on those events to change them. Intuitive theories cover all manner of phenomena, from gravity to geology to illness to adaptation, and they operate from infancy to senescence. The problem is, they are often wrong. Our intuitive theory of illness, for instance, is grounded in behavior, what we should and should not do to stay healthy, not microbes. Thus, it seems incredible that heating milk could render it safer to drink, or that injecting dead viruses into our bodies, as done in vaccination, could confer immunity to live strains of the disease. Likewise, our intuitive theory of geology assumes that the Earth is a static object, not a dynamic system, and thus we find it inconceivable that humans could be changing the Earth itself, causing earthquakes through hydraulic fracking or global warming through carbon emission. Intuitive theories are a double-edged sword. On one hand, they broaden our perspective of the phenomena they seek to explain and refine our interactions with those phenomena, because holding an intuitive theory is better than holding no theory at all. On the other hand, they close our minds to ideas and observations that are inconsistent with those theories, and they keep us from discovering the true nature of how things work. They can cause us not just to misconceive reality, but to be blind to reality, to ignore facts and findings that definitively refute those theories. Thus, my goal in writing this book is to introduce you, the listener, to your own intuitive theories and to help you appreciate when and how those theories may lead you astray. In this book, I hope to convince you of two main ideas. The first is that we do, in fact, get the world wrong, that our intuitive theories in several domains of knowledge carve up the world into entities and processes that do not actually exist. The second is that to get the world right, we need to do more than just change our beliefs. We need to change the very concepts that articulate those beliefs. That is, to get the world right, we cannot simply refine our intuitive theories. We must dismantle them and rebuild them from their foundations. Galileo once decreed that all truths are easy to understand once they are discovered. The point is to discover them. But he was wrong. There are many, many truths that are not easy to understand because they defy our earliest developing and most easily accessed ideas about how the world works. This book is a story of those truths, why they initially elude us, and how we can come to grasp them. The idea that we construct intuitive theories strikes many at first as an overly intellectualized view of how we think about the world. Why would a non-physicist construct a theory of motion or a theory of matter? Why would a non-biologist construct a theory of inheritance or a theory of evolution? We do so because physics and biology are inescapable aspects of human life. We are immersed in physical and biological phenomena every day. We may not care about motion in the abstract, but we care about lifting boxes and pouring cereal, riding bicycles and throwing baseballs. We may not care about matter in the abstract, but we care about melting ice and boiling water, preventing rust and lighting fires. Likewise, we care about inheritance insofar as we want to know how likely it is we'll go bald or whether we are predisposed to cancer, and we care about evolution insofar as we want to know why bacteria develop drug resistance or where dogs came from. While few of us can articulate a detailed theory of matter that can explain both rusting and burning, or a detailed theory of evolution that can explain both drug resistance and canine domestication, we have coherent and systematic ideas about those phenomena nonetheless. Psychologists call intuitive theories intuitive because these ideas are our first attempt to understand the phenomena around us, before we learn scientific theories of those same phenomena. They call intuitive theories theories because these ideas embody a specific kind of knowledge, causal knowledge. Causal knowledge is an understanding of cause and effect relationships. It allows us to make inferences from our observations, inferences about why something happened in the past, explanation, or what is likely to happen in the future, prediction. Much of the causal knowledge embodied by our intuitive theories is learned through experience, but at least some of that knowledge is innate. Whether a piece of knowledge is learned or innate is an empirical question, a question that psychologists answer by studying people of various ages and experiences. Studies with young infants, for instance, suggest that many of our expectations about motion and matter are innate. Studies with adults from different cultures, on the other hand, suggest that many of our expectations about illness and cosmology are shaped by what we hear from the people around us. Nevertheless, all of our intuitive theories are shaped both by innate expectations and by lived experiences. Infants may come into the world with expectations about the behavior of physical objects, but those expectations are further refined by their experience interacting with objects. Likewise, different cultures may subscribe to different theories of illness, but all such theories are grounded in the shared experience of what illness actually looks like. Example, coughing, congestion, fevers. Intuitive theories vary not just in their source, but also in their assumptions about causality. Most theories posit causal mechanisms of a natural, that is, ordinary flavor, but some suggest mechanisms of a supernatural flavor. Causal mechanisms of a natural flavor are, in principle, observable and controllable. They are often labeled with scientific terminology, for example, heat, inertia, gene, natural selection, but they do not actually correspond to scientific ideas. What scientists mean by a term like heat, energy transfer at the molecular level, is a far cry from what non-scientists mean by the same term. An immaterial substance that flows in and out of objects and can be trapped or contained. Causal mechanisms of a supernatural flavor, on the other hand, are beyond the observation and control of mere mortals. Those mechanisms have no counterpart in science, for example, karma, witchcraft, souls, God. But they still provide systematic explanations for natural phenomena, example, displeased ancestors, and systematic means of responding to those phenomena, example, sacrificial offerings. And supernatural explanations are often no less substantive than natural ones. Karma, for instance, is no less substantive an explanation for why we get sick than cold weather or bad air. And divine creation is no less substantive an explanation for where species come from than transmutation, a sudden change in form, or spontaneous generation. Given that we live in a thoroughly scientific world, you might wonder whether intuitive theories are a dying breed, something we constructed in the past for want of scientific information, but we will stop constructing in the future as scientific information becomes more available and more accessible. Rest assured, intuitive theories are not a dying breed. They are a permanent fixture of human cognition because they are the handiwork of children, and children are not likely to be affected by changes in the availability or accessibility of scientific information. It's not because children have shorter attention spans than adults have, or because children are less interested in the natural world than adults are. It's because children lack the concepts needed to encode the scientific information we might teach them. Take, for example, the concept of heat. Children can sense an object's warmth, or how efficiently the object transfers heat to them or from them, but they cannot actually sense its heat, as humans have no sensory apparatus for registering the collective motion of a system's molecules. To understand the scientific concept of heat, children must learn a molecular theory of matter. We do, of course, teach children a molecular theory of matter, but not until they have reached middle school, and by that time, they have already constructed an intuitive theory of heat, a theory that treats heat as a substance rather than as a process, discussed in Chapter 3. We could attempt to forestall this event by introducing a molecular theory of matter earlier in children's education, but a molecular theory is itself counterintuitive. How do you explain a molecule to a preschooler, let alone an electron or a chemical bond? And how do you forestall a child from mapping thermal language, heat, hot, cold, cool, to concepts that the child already understands, which in this case are concepts like substance, containment, and flow? Clearly, many of us do learn a scientific concept of heat, but the task is not trivial. It requires devising an entirely new framework for thinking about thermal phenomena, a framework that differs in kind from the one we create on our own. Psychologists call this type of learning conceptual change. This is not your run-of-the-mill learning, like learning the traits of an unfamiliar animal or the history of an unfamiliar country. Psychologists call that kind of learning knowledge enrichment. What differentiates conceptual change from knowledge enrichment is whether, at the outset of learning, we possess concepts capable of making sense of the information we need to learn. Knowledge enrichment is the process of using old concepts to acquire new beliefs, as when we use the concept of whales, breathing, and air to acquire the belief that whales breathe air. Conceptual change, on the other hand, is the process of acquiring new concepts, or really new types of concepts. If I told you that a species of mouse in the Amazon eats humans, I will have invited you to entertain a new concept, the Amazonian man-eating mouse. But that concept is just a subtype of other concepts you already know. Mouse, which is a subtype of animal, which is a subtype of living thing. We have no trouble learning new instances of pre-existing types. That's just knowledge enrichment in disguise. The trouble comes in learning new types. An analogy with Legos is useful here. A basic Lego set consists of strictly rectangular blocks. With enough rectangular blocks, you can build anything, from a life-size giraffe to a life-size statue of Conan O'Brien, both of which have been built. But there are certain structures that you cannot build. Cars with wheels that roll, planes with propellers that turn, cranes with hooks that lift. To build such structures, you need to supplement your supply of rectangular blocks with new specialty pieces, wheels, axles, gears, and crankshafts. Any vehicle you try to build without those pieces will be ineffective or incomplete. We can approximate a car, but we can't actually build a car. Wheels and axles are a necessity. Much like building an operational Lego car, building a scientific understanding of the world requires resources that are unavailable to the novice learner, that is, to a child. Those resources are concepts like electricity, density, velocity, planet, organ, virus, and common ancestor. Concepts are quite literally the building blocks of thought, and like building blocks, they have particular structures and functions. Entertaining the thought, humans share a common ancestor with daffodils, is not possible without the concept common ancestor. And entertaining the thought, water is denser than ice, is not possible without the concept density. Those concepts are not part of our innate knowledge, nor are they learned from everyday experience with the physical world. They require conceptual change. Conceptual change is a rare, hard-won achievement. It is difficult to initiate and difficult to complete, as I will try to make clear from specific instances of conceptual change presented in each chapter. At this point, however, I hope it is becoming apparent that intuitive theories and conceptual change are intrinsically linked. We construct intuitive theories of natural phenomena because constructing scientific theories of those phenomena requires conceptual change. But to achieve conceptual change, we must overhaul intuitive theories constructed in the absence of a scientific theory. Why we get the world wrong, intuitive theories, is our answer to how to get the world right, conceptual change. But getting the world right cannot happen without first getting the world wrong. It's a circular notion, but not hopelessly circular. We are, after all, capable of getting the world right. Intuitive theories are a prime source of misconceptions, but they're not the only source of misconceptions. Most of our misconceptions are simply factual errors, typos of the mind. Many people believe that we use only 10% of our brain, and that the taste buds on our tongue are divided into distinct sections, but neither belief is true. These misconceptions do not signify a profound confusion about brains or tongues. They are just byproducts of misinformation. Distinguishing factual errors from deep-seated misconceptions is critical if we hope to identify and study intuitive theories. Many psychologists have grappled with this issue and have come to identify three hallmarks that set intuitive theories apart from other sources of misconceptions. First, intuitive theories are coherent. They embody a logically consistent set of beliefs and expectations. Second, intuitive theories are widespread. They are shared by people of different ages, cultures, and historical periods. Third, intuitive theories are robust. They are resistant to change in the face of counter-evidence or counter-instruction. To get a better sense of these hallmarks, consider the following two thought experiments, which are designed to pump your intuition about physical motion. First, imagine you're standing in a large open field holding a gun. You aim the gun at the horizon and shoot a bullet parallel to the ground. As you pull the trigger, you drop a second bullet from the same height as the gun. Which bullet hits the ground first? The one you shot or the one you dropped? Second, imagine you're in the crow's nest of a ship sailing at full speed across the open sea. Next to you is a cannonball. You drop the cannonball out of the crow's nest and watch it fall. Where does it land? On the deck of the ship or in the water behind the ship? If you're like most people, you predicted that the dropped bullet would hit the ground before the shot bullet, reasoning that the shot bullet had been imparted a forward-propelling force that would keep it aloft longer. You also predicted that the cannonball would fall behind the ship, reasoning that the ship would sail out from underneath the cannonball as it fell straight down. Neither prediction is correct, however. The shot bullet would have no extra force keeping it aloft. As soon as both bullets were released, they would be subject to a single force, gravity, and gravity would bring them to the ground at the same time, albeit hundreds of yards apart. As for the cannonball, it would hit the deck of the ship directly below the crow's nest because the ball would have the same horizontal velocity as the ship on which it was carried. It's true that the ship would sail out from beneath the cannonball's release point, but the cannonball would not fall straight down. It would trace a parabolic path, produced by the combination of its horizontal velocity and its downward acceleration due to gravity, in the same direction as the ship. Most people's predictions in these two situations are wrong, but that's not because there's something weird about the situations. Both involve nothing more than falling objects. Our predictions are wrong because they arise from an intuitive theory of motion that assumes that objects move if and only if they have been imparted an internal force or impetus. The term force has been put in quotations here because our intuitive notion of force is not what scientists mean by force, the product of mass and acceleration. Forces may change an object's motion, but they are not properties of objects. They are interactions between objects, as discussed in Chapter 5. That said, our non-scientific beliefs about force and the relation between force and motion are highly coherent. Take, for instance, the two misconceptions primed before. The misconception that an object with horizontal motion, a shot bullet, will succumb to gravity less quickly than will an object with no such motion, a dropped bullet. And the misconception that a carried object, a cannonball, does not inherit the horizontal motion of its carrier, a ship. These misconceptions may seem unrelated, but they are products of the same underlying belief, that projectiles, and only projectiles, have forces imparted to them. We attribute a forward-propelling force to the shot bullet, but not to the dropped bullet, and not to the cannonball, which was also dropped. The force we attribute to the shot bullet is thought to keep it aloft for longer than the dropped bullet, whereas the absence of such a force is thought to cause the cannonball to fall straight down. These ideas, though wrong, are internally consistent. They are also incredibly widespread. Impetus-based misconceptions have been found in students of all ages, from preschoolers to college graduates, They have been revealed in China, Israel, Mexico, Turkey, Ukraine, the Philippines, and the United States. And they have been revealed even in students who have taken multiple years of college-level physics. You can earn a bachelor's degree in physics and still be an impetus theorist at heart. This consistency across individuals extends backward in time as well. People have always been impetus theorists, including professional physicists of centuries past. Galileo, for instance, explained projectile motion as follows. The body moves upward, provided the impressed motive force is greater than the resisting weight. But since that force is continually weakened, it will finally become so diminished that it will no longer overcome the weight of the body. This explanation smacks of impetus, not inertia. And it is the same kind of explanation most of us would provide today, 4 centuries later. No one today would use the phrase impressed motive force, but we would express those same ideas with terms like internal energy, force of motion, or momentum. To a physicist, momentum is the product of mass and velocity. But to a non-physicist, momentum is simply impetus. What is remarkable about the sustained popularity of an intuitive theory like impetus theory from Galileo's time to today is that we've always had reason to doubt it. Impetus theory makes predictions that are never confirmed because objects move in ways that do not actually accord with those predictions. When a cannonball is shot from a cannon, it traces a fully parabolic path. It never drops straight down, as impetus theory predicts it should, because impetus theory predicts that the cannonball will eventually lose its impetus and succumb to gravity. Yet, if we are asked to draw the trajectory of a cannonball shot from a cannon, we draw paths that begin parabolic but end straight down, paths we have never observed or ever could observe in real life. Impetus theory can successfully explain some aspects of reality, but it renders us blind to the aspects it cannot. Impetus theory is not unique in this regard. All intuitive theories are coherent in their internal logic, widespread across people, and robust in the face of counter-evidence. And this trifecta gives them a surprising amount of resilience. While we can learn new, more accurate theories of a phenomenon, we cannot seem to unlearn our intuitive theories. They continue to lurk in the recesses of our minds long after we have abandoned them as our preferred theory. Intuitive theories influence our thoughts and behaviors in subtle yet appreciable ways. A prime example can be seen in our judgments of whether something is alive. To a 4-year-old, what makes something alive is that it moves on its own. 4-year-olds thus deny that plants are alive because plants do not appear to move on their own. 8-year-olds, on the other hand, recognize that plants are alive because children this age have stopped identifying life with mobility and have started identifying life with metabolic processes, like growth and reproduction, discussed in Chapter 8. The childish misconception that plants are not alive would thus appear to be erased from our brains within the first decade of life. Nevertheless, when college-educated adults are asked to verify the life status of plants and animals as quickly as possible, they take longer to verify that plants are alive than to verify that animals are alive. They are also less accurate for plants, judging plants as not alive more often than judging animals as not alive. Findings like these, which have been replicated in several domains of science, example astronomy, mechanics, evolution, using several types of methods, example perception tasks, memory tasks, inference tasks, have radically altered our understanding of conceptual change. Because conceptual change requires knowledge restructuring, not just knowledge enrichment, it has long been assumed that restructuring one's knowledge erases pre-existing concepts in the same way that restructuring a house erases its pre-existing floor plans. but the discovery that scientific theories never completely overwrite a person's intuitive theories suggests that a better metaphor for conceptual change is a palimpsest, or a manuscript in which one document has been physically recorded on top of another. Palimpsests were common in the Middle Ages because parchment was scarce, and the monks who recorded documents on parchment would often reuse old pieces of parchment without fully erasing the earlier contents. Like a palimpsest, our minds record new theories, scientific theories, on top of old theories, intuitive theories, such that both theories can become active at the same time, providing competing explanations or competing predictions. Motion-based theories of life compete with metabolic theories. Substance-based theories of heat compete with process-based theories. And impetus-based theories of motion compete with inertia-based theories. In some cases, our scientific knowledge may be nothing more than a veneer, thinly covering misconceptions forged decades earlier, when we were children. In a recent article titled, "I Know What's Best for the Health of My Family and It's Magical Thinking," a satirist pokes fun at science denial by channeling a well-meaning yet science-denying mother. "I'm not stupid," she writes. "I went to college. I took science classes. So I know about microbiology, infection control, anatomy, physiology, and all that. I am fully aware that the scientific method, including use of a control group, randomization, double-blind studies, and the peer review method, is the best tool we humans have of unlocking the secrets of the natural world to find ways of curing disease. Science is great. It's done a lot of good for the world, to be sure. It's just not right for me or my family." Well captured here is the paradoxical nature of science denial in a world dominated by science. Most science deniers are not ignorant of science. They are skeptical of science. Their skepticism arises from many sources: political beliefs, religious beliefs, cultural identity. But in this book, I hope to convince you that at least one of those sources is intuitive theories. As someone who has chosen to read a book on intuitive theories and how they blind us to reality, you are probably not an ardent science denier yourself, but you may know science deniers, and you certainly live in a society whose policies and practices are shaped by science deniers. More importantly, you probably deny science in unintentional and unrecognized ways. Some of your attitudes are likely based on non-scientific considerations, and some of your behaviors probably run counter to sound scientific advice. No one could be an expert on all areas of science, let alone apply that expertise to all areas of life, but we can be more informed about the cognitive obstacles to doing so. Accordingly, this book aims to show you what your intuitive theories are like and how those theories influence your beliefs, attitudes, and behaviors. The first half of the book is devoted to intuitive theories of the physical world, theories of matter, energy, gravity, motion, the cosmos, and the earth, and the second half to intuitive theories of the biological world, theories of life, growth, inheritance, illness, adaptation, and ancestry. Each theory is unique in its origin, its pattern of development, and its relation to everyday experience. Some theories are held explicitly by children, but only implicitly by adults, biasing our thoughts and behaviors at the periphery of conscious experience. Others are held explicitly, even by adults, biasing our thoughts and behaviors in the here and now. Together, these two types of cases underscore the pervasiveness and perniciousness of intuitive theories, how they operate across the lifespan and within the minds of even the most scientifically literate people. To be sure, intuitive theories are not all bad. If they were, we wouldn't construct them. They furnish us with a reasonable approximation of reality, and thus a reasonable basis for intervening on that reality. Intuitive theories help us get by. Scientific theories, on the other hand, help us thrive. They furnish us with fundamentally more accurate conceptions of reality and thus fundamentally more powerful tools for predicting it and controlling it. Studies have shown, for instance, that the better we understand the biological mechanisms of cold and flu transmission, the more likely we are to take precautions against catching colds and flu. The better we understand thermal equilibrium, the more likely we are to optimize our home heating and cooling practices. And the better we understand how the body metabolizes food, the more likely we are to maintain a healthy body mass index. Failing to understand science has palpable consequences as well. Thousands have fallen ill to preventable diseases because they intentionally consumed unpasteurized milk or deliberately avoided vaccination. By blinding us to science, intuitive theories impede not just how we think, but how we live. The choices we make, the advice we take, the goals we pursue. In the chapters that follow, I hope to convince you that it's not just science that's best for the health of your family, it's also knowledge of science that's best. Part 1. Intuitive Theories of the Biological World. 2. Matter. What is the world made of? How do those components interact? When we watch a candle burn or a pot of water boil, we watch matter seemingly vanish into thin air. The wax disappears from the candlestick and the water disappears from the pot. But neither has truly vanished. They've just changed state, from visible wax to invisible carbon dioxide and water vapor, and from visible water to invisible steam. Matter may appear ephemeral, but it's actually indestructible. Chemists tell us that matter can be neither created nor destroyed, but common sense tells us that matter comes and goes, here one moment, gone the next. This common sense view of matter is held by people of all ages, but it is most easily demonstrated in children. You can demonstrate it for yourself if you know a preschooler who can serve as a test subject. Get two transparent containers, one tall and thin, and one short and squat. Fill the short, squat container half full of water and show the child. Then pour the water from the short, squat container into the tall, thin container and ask, is there now more water, less water, or the same amount of water as there was before? The water column in the second container will be higher than it was in the first, so the child will probably claim that there is now more water. Transferring water from one container to another is all it takes to convince the child that you've performed an impossible feat. You've made more water. If you have ever taken an introductory psychology course, you may recognize this parlor trick as Piaget's conservation task. Jean Piaget was a Swiss psychologist who pioneered the study of child development in the early 1900s. He discovered several intriguing phenomena. Childhood realism, mistaking appearances for reality, childhood animism, attributing life to non-living entities, childhood artificialism, attributing human design to nature, and childhood egocentrism, assuming others know what you know. But the phenomenon he is best known for is conservation, or children's lack thereof. There are many versions of the conservation task, and young children fail them all. In another version, children are shown two equal-sized balls of clay and are asked to confirm that they contain the same amount of clay, have the same weight, and take up the same amount of space. If a child denies they do, he or she is asked to nullify the difference by moving pinches of clay from one ball to the other. One of the balls is then flattened into a pancake, and children are asked whether the two configurations of clay, the ball and the pancake, still contain the same amount of clay, conservation of mass, still have the same weight, conservation of weight, and still take up the same amount of space, conservation of volume. Preschoolers typically answer all three questions no, and elementary schoolers typically answer one or two questions no. Not until middle school do children reliably recognize that flattening a ball of clay does not change its mass, weight, or volume. Piaget's explanation for children's lack of conservation was that they have not yet acquired an operational logic of thought. He termed their thinking pre-operational, and he believed this type of thinking permeated all aspects of their mental life, not just their reasoning about conservation. Young children's inferences about physical causality and their evaluations of moral behavior were deemed pre-operational as well. Psychologists today no longer endorse the distinction between operational and pre-operational thought. They doubt Piaget's conclusions for a number of reasons, the most prominent of which is that children develop logical competence at different rates in different domains. For instance, children master the logic of natural language, grammar, and the logic of natural numbers, counting, before they enter school. But they master the logic of deductive reasoning, proofs, and the logic of proportional reasoning, fractions, only after a decade of formal schooling, if then. Even within the domain of conservation, children learn to conserve mass before they learn to conserve weight, and they learn to conserve weight before they learn to conserve volume. Conservation is not a unitary notion, acquired in full or not at all. It is a consequence of knowing whether specific transformations change specific properties of specific materials. Flattening a ball of clay will not change its volume, but heating it will. And heating a ball of clay will not change its weight, but sending it to the moon will. A lot of matter-specific knowledge is required to pass conservation tasks, which makes conservation an odd task for studying cognitive development in general. Following Piaget, developmental psychologists have conducted thousands of studies of conservation, but I doubt they would have studied conservation much at all if Piaget had not initially steered the field in that direction. Material phenomena are too mysterious and too varied to expect young children to instinctively know when material properties are conserved and when they are not. Matter is conserved across many transformations where it blatantly appears not to be. Water evaporating from an open container, steam escaping from a boiling pot, hot doors expanding in their frames, logs burning to ash. And many properties of matter are not conserved across transformations that conserve matter as a whole. The volume of water when frozen, the elasticity of a rubber band when stretched, the granularity of salt when dissolved, the viscosity of cake batter when baked. Preschoolers' belief that transferring water from a short, squat container into a tall, thin container increases the water's mass can hardly be classified as a logical error when the reality of material transformations is so opaque. To be fair, Piaget was interested in conservation not just as it pertained to matter, but as it pertained to quantities in general, including numerical quantities and spatial quantities. Rearranging a collection of toys does not change its number in the same way that squashing a ball of clay does not change its weight, and Piaget wanted to know when and how children grasped the necessity of that conclusion. Piaget's successors, on the other hand, were often captivated by conservation errors for a different reason. Those errors are incredibly persistent. Perhaps the most straightforward approach to correcting children's conservation errors is to instruct children to attend to multiple dimensions of a material transformation, say, the spread of water in a container and not just its height. But this kind of instruction has little effect on their errors, particularly if children are tested weeks or months later. In one study, several hundred children received one of four types of instructions on conservation. Some were provided with explicit feedback on their conservation judgments. Some were encouraged to make judgments before witnessing the relevant transformations. Some were shown how those transformations could easily be reversed. And some were instructed on the logical reasons why mass and volume are conserved across material transformations. Children's understanding of conservation was then assessed three times over 5 months. The results were discouraging. Children's understanding of conservation did not improve at any time under any form of instruction. Surprisingly, the instruction used in this study, as well as the instruction used in many other studies, lacked content about matter itself. Piaget characterized children's conservation errors as failures of logic, and accordingly, many psychologists have attempted to correct those errors with logic-based instruction. An alternative approach, however, is to focus on the causes of conservation, namely, that material substances are composed of smaller particles and that those particles can neither be created nor destroyed outside of a nuclear reaction. Any chemist asked to teach children about the conservation of matter would most likely start with molecules, not equivalence relations or quantitative invariance, and taking such an approach has indeed proven effective, as discussed later on. Thus, several decades after Piaget introduced the conservation task as a measure of children's logical reasoning, we now know that children fail that task not because they are illogical, but because they misunderstand the nature of matter. Atoms are the constituents of matter, comprising all solids, liquids, and gases. "Do not trust atoms," warns one internet meme. "They make up everything." Children cannot perceive atoms and are thus ignorant of their existence, as were all humans before the pioneering work of 19th century chemists like John Dalton, who discovered the principles of chemical synthesis, and J.J. Thomson, who discovered the electron. Nothing about our perceptual experience of matter would suggest that matter is particulate in nature. Much of the matter around us comes in discrete, bounded packages. Rocks, trees, logs, bricks, tables, chairs, shoes, hats, pencils, hammers. These objects betray no sign of their molecular composition. They appear continuous and holistic. In addition to being unaware of the microscopic components of macroscopic objects, we also misperceive the properties of those objects. All matter has weight and volume. But humans are not built to detect weight and volume. We are built to detect heft, felt weight, and bulk, visible volume. Heft differs from weight in that it conflates weight with density. Objects of the same weight can differ in heft if they also differ in density. Example, a 10-pound piece of steel feels heavier than a 10-pound piece of styrofoam. Bulk differs from volume in that bulk conflates volume with surface area. Objects of the same volume can differ in bulk if they also differ in surface area. Example, a blanket in a heap is bulkier than a blanket that is folded. The subjective nature of heft and bulk allows them to vary in ways that weight and volume do not. All matter has weight, but not all matter has heft. Example, snowflakes, dust. Likewise, all matter has volume, but not all matter has bulk. Example, helium, steam. This collection of perceptions, that matter is continuous, that matter has heft, that matter has bulk, forms the basis of children's first theory of matter, a holistic theory, eventually replaced in late adolescence by a particulate theory. Conservation errors are consistent with a holistic theory of matter in that changing the appearance of a substance, its height, its width, its spread, is deemed synonymous with changing the substance itself. But conservation errors are not the only evidence of holistic theories. Other evidence comes from children's judgments of what is matter and what is not. When asked whether solid objects are composed of matter, example, rocks, trees, logs, bricks, preschoolers and elementary schoolers unanimously agree that they are. They also agree that non-solid substances are composed of matter if those substances can be seen and touched. Example, water, salt, juice, jelly. But they vacillate on whether less tangible material substances, examples, dust, clouds, ink blots, bubbles, are composed of matter. They also vacillate on whether visible yet immaterial entities, examples, shadows, rainbows, lightning, sunshine, are composed of matter. children are particularly confused about air. They know that air is all around them and that they take air into their lungs, but they judge it as non-material. They also claim that air has no volume. For example, that the air inside an empty box takes up no space at all. Air defies the very core of children's holistic theories of matter, as it has volume that cannot be seen, no bulk, and weight that cannot be felt, no heft. Children's holistic theories are also evident from their predictions of sinking and floating. The primary determinant of whether an object will sink or float is its average density. But children have no sensory apparatus for gauging an object's density. They can only gauge heft and bulk, which leads to systematic patterns of error. In one study, 4-year-olds were shown blocks of varying weights and sizes and asked to predict whether each would sink or float. Most children adopted a criterion based on weight. They predicted that blocks under 100 grams would float and that blocks over 100 grams would sink, regardless of whether the density of those blocks was above or below the density of water. Thus, children's predictions were correct for light blocks with below threshold densities and heavy blocks with above threshold densities, but incorrect for light blocks with above threshold densities and heavy blocks with below threshold densities. Other studies have found that children can be prompted to integrate weight and size, thereby approximating density, but they rarely do so on their own. Density is simply not salient on a holistic theory of matter. An even purer demonstration of children's holistic theories comes from studies in which children are asked to contemplate a material transformation that would be impossible to perceive: microscopic division. Children are shown a piece of styrofoam and are asked to imagine what would happen to the styrofoam's mass, weight, and volume if it were halved ad infinitum. This interview between a researcher and a third grader illustrates how children younger than 10 typically respond. Researcher: imagine it is possible to divide this tiny piece in half and in half again. If we kept dividing the tiny pieces in half and in half, would the styrofoam matter ever disappear completely? Child: yes, after a year, it would stop. There wouldn't be anything left. Researcher: now imagine a tiny piece of styrofoam, so tiny that you couldn't see it. Would that tiny piece take up any space at all? Child: no, because if you have really big things on a table and kept it in the corner, it wouldn't take up any space. Researcher: would that tiny piece have any weight? Child: nothing at all. Researcher: 0 grams? Child: yes, because if you took a tiny piece off, it would just feel like your own skin because it doesn't weigh anything. Notice how this child explicitly equates volume with bulk. The tiny piece could be kept in a corner, and weight with heft. It would just feel like your skin. Older children, in contrast, provide a qualitatively different pattern of results. Researcher: imagine it is possible to divide this tiny piece in half and in half again. If we kept dividing the tiny pieces in half and in half, would the styrofoam matter ever disappear completely? Child: half of that is still something, and half of that is very, very tiny, but it's still something. There's no one object that half of it is nothing. Researcher: if we kept dividing the tiny pieces in half and in half again, would we ever get to a piece that does not take up any space? Child: no. No matter how tiny it is, as long as it's matter, it takes up space. Researcher: would we ever get to a piece that has no weight? Child: it would be unmeasurable, but it would have weight. If a tiny person tried to pick it up, it would have weight to him. this sixth grader clearly views matter as indestructible, attributing weight and volume to matter even when that matter is too small to be seen. She was inclined to identify weight with heft, like the child in the previous example, but she recognized that her own perception of heft, or lack thereof, was irrelevant to whether the object still had weight, hence the appeal to a tiny person. One final source of evidence for holistic theories is the confusion that children experience as they begin to learn about gases, typically in middle school. Middle schoolers might accept that gases are composed of matter, but they have trouble connecting the macroscopic properties of gases to microscopic particles. Children initially construe gases as holistic, homogeneous entities, just as they initially construed solids. This notion leads them to deny that gas particles are in constant motion, that gas particles are separated by empty space, and that the spacing of gas particles depends on the volume of the gas as a whole. Many adults deny these ideas as well. We may know a lot of things about the relation between a solid's macroscopic properties, example buoyancy, and its microscopic properties, example density, but we have yet to learn those ideas anew for gases. Children's understanding of matter is an outgrowth of infants' understanding of matter, and for many years, psychologists believed that infants had no such understanding at all. Infants were thought to lack object permanence, or the insight that objects continue to exist.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.